and sensational findings have emerged from a survey that has been done, a survey that has been done by CSDS and an NGO called Common Cause. They interviewed about 12,000 policemen. They also interviewed their families across over 20 different states. The survey, a chapter of it, focuses on the state of policing, on the attitude of the policemen. And this is really, really insightful. Stay with me on it. Here are the top takeaways from the survey. 1 in 2 policemen who were surveyed of these 12,000 believe that Muslims are somewhat prone to or more prone to crime in this country. 35% of these cops who were interviewed and surveyed believe that mob violence is justified for cow slaughter. Think about it, 35% of those wearing a uniform surveyed here believe mob violence because of cow slaughter is justified. 43% felt that it was natural for a mob to punish someone who is accused of rape. These are our law enforcers. These men are supposed to be our protectors. This is what they believe. 37% said cops can hand out punishment for minor offenses. 72% said they have experienced political pressure during an investigation against influential people. Truth that has emerged from a survey done of 12,000 cops across this country. Less than half of them feel that scheduled castes and scheduled tribes within the police department itself are given equal treatment. Less than half feel that there is equality within their own department. That SC/ST personnel believe there is discrimination that exists. That 1 in 3 of these people, these cops who were surveyed, believe that minorities are not given equal treatment. And 1 in 5 believe that complaints under the SC/ST Act are false. 1 in 5 actually believe these complaints are false. 60% believe that migrants are prone to committing crimes. All of this as per the Status of Policing in India report 2019. What does that show you about a police force? What does that tell you about the mindset of that police force? And is this why you and I sit day after day, night after night, discussing cases where the police seems to have failed us? Because of their mindset. What should be done is the big question. Let's say good evening to our panelists. And straight up first, I actually want to go across to Brinda DK, social activist joining us from Bengaluru. Brinda, let me, and you deal with a lot of these cases, you know, you deal with police quite often. Are you surprised by some of these findings? Are you surprised that this survey effectively is telling us that many in our police force are communal, are bigoted?
I am not at all surprised, but I think, like any other ordinary citizen, I want to feel the shock. I am shocked. I also want to feel that outrage that 72 years down the line, we still have a police system that continues to be colonial in nature, exactly how it was formed in 1861. And that is not simply dangerous. It also shows that you have no regard for the Constitution and the citizens. Though you claim to be protectors, you also continue to function as an organization and operate also in the same manner as when you were formed in 1861. 6 reforms have gone through, police reforms across India. How much of those reforms have been put into place? We still continue to see a very, very stark difference. And of course, you know, this group that comes through the IPS and the people in the lower echelons of the police ladder. And their working system is very different. We also see that the preventive measures are normally taken by the constables who are very, very lowly, poorly paid and who work many, many hours. That apart, We also know the political nexus that is there. All people over there, you know that whenever the government changes, immediately there are transfers. How is it that you have reforms and you continue to function like this? And whatever was this survey that was pointed out is so true, so very true, even today. We might claim that we've gone to moon, but we cannot claim that the police are there out as people who protect the citizens. It is more for the influential, for those who are powerful, and those who might have the money. Yes, and sir. Like you mentioned in the survey, it is the most vulnerable people and marginalized people who suffer the most.
Yes, absolutely. And for everybody who says that, oh no, this is not what our country is about today, these differences don't exist anymore, here is the truth. This is how deeply rooted it is that even your law enforcement agency, even the personnel within that agency are unable to keep their biases, their mindset aside to do a, you know, complete fair job. Vipul Mudgal, Director for Common Cause and also a trustee for ADR, joins us this evening. Swaranjit Sen, former DGP of Andhra Pradesh, also with us this evening. And Sanjay Kumar, political scientist, director for CSDS. So this is actually a survey done in collaboration of CSDS and Common Cause. Let me go across to Mr. Vipul Mudgal first. Mr. Mudgal, good evening. Can you help us understand, you know, how you carried this out?
Good evening.
And the extent of this survey, actually.
Actually, this is part of a series of surveys that we are carrying out. Last year, we had the Status of Police in India report 2018, and this year it's 2019. So these are going to be almost like baseline documents, baseline literature on the state of the police in India. And this is like a political party agnostic. It does not matter which party is ruling in the state. It is basically a very scientific survey in which the questionnaires are decided after a very long process, brainstorming, etc., and in which the questions are asked very differently. It's a Sanjay Kumarji will tell you that it's a team of people who know surveys since 1950s in India. So, you know, when you ask somebody that, say, what is your opinion about cow slaughter, then the people will give you politically correct answers or desirable answers. So you ask questions very differently. You start asking them about what happens when there is an accident and it seems that the mistake was made by the driver. And then is it okay in this kind of situation for the mobs to kill this guy? Then they say, yeah, maybe when it is his mistake, then it is but natural for people to take law in their own hands. Then you ask the second question and the third question. So it works like that. There are many times when you ask very, very indirect questions. So, and it is not just about attitudes and sensitivities. It is also about their working conditions. And as you also pointed out, that some places they are working 16 hours a day. In Odisha, it was like a cop after cop told us that 18 hours a day. I mean, is that humanly possible for anybody? Which means people finish a day's duty, beat routine, and come back and do another duty in the office and perhaps sleep in the police station. This is ridiculous. And if they are fatigued and if they are exasperated, you know, how can we expect anything else? So I think the survey was carried out to bring out all of these things. It's not just about Muslims. It's not just about Dalits. It is about police working conditions. And more importantly here is about the training. We are giving training to only 6.4% people. So what else do we expect?
Absolutely. And you know, we'll touch on all of these aspects one by one. But we're just getting into this conversation from a previous conversation that I had about this case, where again I said I don't want to get into the merits of this case, but it was a case of a young law student who made significant serious allegations against a person. She went missing. It took police full 3 days after that to file an FIR against that person who was highly influential, highly connected. And it begs me to ask the same question. Why? Mr. Sanjay Kumar, do you think the answer lies in the findings of your report? Because, you know, A, there could be political pressures. B, there are prejudices. You know, often the policemen themselves are unable to keep their own views and biases aside and do an honest job.
No, as someone who is part of the team which has conducted a recent survey on policing in India, and that survey clearly indicates that police are working, the entire police force is working under a lot of pressure. And the survey, in the survey, we talk about two kinds of pressure, and these are interviews of 12,000 policemen across the country. They talk about pressure from politicians. They also talk about pressure from their senior colleagues. So the case which you are mentioned, which you have mentioned, may be a case of this kind. You did mention that for the last 3 days, even the FIR has not been lodged, even, you know, some investigation has not taken place. I think there is a clear indication that there must be some pressure, political pressure, as well as pressure from the department. And the data clearly indicates, this study clearly indicates, that there is a lot of pressure on policemen when they try and fulfill their duties, when they try and function as a cop, that they are under a lot of pressure from political bosses and also from their own senior colleagues.
Absolutely. Mr. Swaranjit Sen, how do we expect, you know, a police force to do an honest, fair investigation if, you know, even if one third of them actually believe that there is liable to be a mob reaction to a story of a cow slaughter, that there is liable to be a mob reaction to a serious charge of rape, who believe that they themselves are facing discrimination, that minorities and the lower caste face discrimination within the police department itself. And of course, like I pointed out initially, this is not just a survey of the 12,000 policemen, it's also spoken to their families. So it's a larger reflection of the mindset within the system.
Yeah, but I came a little late, so I would like to focus on exactly what the topic is for today's discussion. If you can kindly give me that,
yes,
I will be able to react.
Mr. Sen, the topic is this, exactly that, survey reflects that, you know, one third of the police force or the policemen who were surveyed actually believe that there are Muslims who are somewhat prone to or more prone to crimes in this country, that there is a significant population of the policemen who were surveyed who believe that it is all right for a mob to respond in a case of a cow slaughter, that there are biases that exist within policemen when it comes to bias against minorities and lower caste.
Well, yes. Now, I would like to say that this kind of bias has always existed with varying degrees from state to state. And it has been directly related to the police leadership and police administration. But now, in the recent past, what has happened? 5 years ago, this business of attack on minorities took place. First, it was the Christians, then the Dalits, and then Gaurakshaks and all that kind of thing. So what has happened is that the public seems to have felt that they can take law into their own hands. Mm. That is one thing. Secondly, the way in the last 5 years the government has reacted, there is a greater polarization which has taken place between the larger community and the minorities. And this, I'm sorry to say, has been fanned in the last 5 years. Now, why is it that when all these offenses took place with such terrible regularity, the PM did not speak about it? It is only now that he has started speaking about it. So what is this game? Is it an introduction, or do they feel that the land has been laid for fascism to grow? When that is so, you have a larger community which is in the largest numbers in the police forces.
Hmm.
And definitely they will be affected. So if somebody says that this is not the reason, I'm sorry, I disagree totally. Because I've seen it over the ages and I'm seeing it now much more polarized. And I'm talking about Andhra Pradesh, now Telangana, where there has been a lot of tolerance and a lot of harmony between all communities. But today I find some of the police officers I'm talking about, the leadership, is polarized. Why? What has happened? What are the reasons? That is one aspect of this. The other aspect is that we have to recognize the fact that the Muslims are in poorer financially. Second thing is that they have more children to support. They don't have the wherewithal. So what do? They send them to schools like madrasas. I was shocked, you know, because most of my time I do spend in a Muslim-dominated area, that's Golconda and all. I was interacting with so many of the youngsters. These youngsters are in the age group of, let us say, 17 to 22. Okay, and I asked them general questions about the world. They're totally blank. What happens? I said, where have you studied? In a madrasa. I said, what did you learn there? The Quran. You see, so their minds have been so compartmentalized and they are so ill-equipped to take on the community or take on life when they have to come out of it. And then they are the persons who marry very early. So, you know, it becomes a spiraling effect that takes place where their mindset is concerned. They have to look to easy ways of making money. And that is how they get influenced by the terrorist groups and the criminal groups. They are good people, but they have no choice. Why? Because of the way they have been brought up. I'm sorry, I don't want to offend any group. Because, by the way, I have married my children into various communities, religious groups. I have nothing against anyone. But these are major concerns. As a patriotic person who has the best interests of the country, that, you know, these are two incidents, two conflicting sort of situations which have to be dealt with.
Okay.
The polarization
yes.
In the last 5 years.
So you've raised two very important issues, Mr. Sain. One is obviously your own observation, and perhaps that is also a reflection of your thought and many others in the police department who may have been surveyed, and so that's where it comes from. The second, like you said, is the impact of the current environment or political setup, so to speak. Brinda D.K., let's take it point by point. Point number one, political environment. Do you think that impacts the mindset as well? Or is it something that we've seen government after government when it comes to minorities and the underprivileged or the lower caste, they just don't care?
I think we need to address this issue of governments or people in governance and the way they look at the issues like minorities, Muslims and the Dalits. And that is very important. What is the message that is going across? What kind of statements are made? What are the statements that are condoned? What actions are condoned? What is it that remains silent? And I think the leadership, to a very large extent, puts that narrative into space. And that is the narrative that also gets carried across. And when you say all this responses that was given by Mr. Sen, I think I don't want to accept it immediately. Poverty is in different places. Poverty is among different religions. Poverty is there among different regions. But you cannot say something like, oh, because they have too many children, because they only do this. Lot of different factors affect. What we need to ask ourselves is, as a nation, what is the narrative that my leadership is talking about loudly? What is the narrative that is silently condoned? And that, I think, the face of the government very many times is the police. And it depends on how police react and how police interact.
You know,
I
have picked up cases.
You know that the police is always interpreting.
Correct. I have picked up some cases which are from different places at different points of time which show police failure in different ways. They may or may not be connected politically. They may or they may not be connected over what the narrative nationally is at that point. They may actually simply be about the individual bias and the prejudice that the police at that point have. But take the example of Muzaffarnagar riots. Riots where at least over 60 people were killed. Dozens of cases filed. we are literally yet to see a single acquittal. Question marks have to be raised against the police department in that specific case. Muzaffarnagar riots in 2013 took place when there was a Samajwadi party in power in Uttar Pradesh. Let's take a look at Malegaon blast case of 2008. Witnesses have changed stand, witnesses have turned, evidence has come and gone. The investigating agencies have actually changed their stand. And so forth. For a decade now, that case drags on. You know, there's several questions that one must ask of the investigative agency, of the police and the others in that specific case. Take the example of Pehlu Khan. The evidence was there. It was just not taken in properly, recorded properly, presented properly, and so it wasn't admissible in court. Today we have a situation where those accused of lynching Pehlu Khan in Rajasthan have been acquitted. We don't know who killed Pehlu Khan. Take the example of Akbar Khan. Similarly, in the same district, in Alwar, just a few months later, another case happens. Absolutely no justice because a complete investigation is botched up. Governments have changed there, but the fate of these cases have not changed. Take the case. So these are some of the cases that I have put together. So many more, including the one I was just talking about in Uttar Pradesh, including the Unnao rape case. Mr. Mudgal, do you then believe that it is simply to do with the political environment? Or there has to be some inherent bias as well, that the police force itself is not able to fix with training?
No, there are both, actually. The political environment is vicious, there is no doubt about it. And political environment, some people can increase the heat if they want, it is necessary for their electoral gains, etc. Excuse me. So the other thing is that the police, there is a brutalization and dehumanization of police, which is also taking place.
Correct.
Say, for instance, when there is something like police being extremely brutal and inhuman with transgender community. I don't think there's any politician which is putting pressure on them to be brutal with, say, a custodial rape case against a Dalit woman. I don't think there is any message coming from any politician. So one issue is of police brutality, lack of sensitivity, and the other issue is of whenever it comes to cases of influential people, then there is departmental pressure and political pressure together. So I think we are dealing with two different kind of situations. One is police reforms and the other is police accountability. And both have to be established.
Yeah.
And I think both people before me had a point about, what is going on in the country. At the same time, police will have to be trained and sensitized. There is no way in which, a large number of them said, the cases of domestic violence filed by women are all bogus. Now, this kind of mentality comes only when you don't get trained in this at all. There should be training in constitutionality. The liberty, the equality, the justice part of Indian constitution should be taught.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Mr. Sanjay Kumar, do you want to add to that? How do we fix this problem? Sensitization and, I want to say police reforms, but at the end of the day, it comes down to the political will and we don't see any of that to bring in the reforms. So what can the police department by itself do?
No, Vipul has already mentioned that there is not just one single problem. There could be multiple problems through which, based on which we see the police not functioning properly. One is political pressure. I don't know that there is any way of, easing the police from political pressure. So whatever options are available with us, I think one viable option is to sensitize the police, indulge them or organize better training for them. And these training should not be only about how to handle the new weapons, how to handle the crowd, but also this training should be focused on sensitizing the policemen with regard to vulnerable communities. How do you deal with these vulnerable communities when we talk about, say, Dalit, Muslims, women, and similar such communities? So I think one quick action could be organize more training camps, organize more training workshops, and this could be one way of handling this problem of attitude.
Okay. So here is the other aspect then. Mr. Sen, please come in on this. Political pressure is probably very difficult to get rid of, in any given environment, irrespective of who the government is. Then how do we fix this problem? Reform, sensitization, it only works when the policemen know that they can do an honest job and they will be allowed to survive with it. I mean, if this, a policeman knows that in this state, under this government, I can put in 10 criminals behind the bar and everybody will be happy with me, and then I genuinely don't need to look into real crime which is happening, and so it's fine, I don't need to bother about that. How do you change that mindset when that's the messaging that's coming from the government?
Well, I would like to say, and I've said it so many times on TV, you can't change a mindset after you get them at a mature age of 24 and 30. You have to have a better selection system. You have to have a psychological test for all these people right from the top to bottom. No amount of training, sensitization will have a lasting effect. I've heard this so many times, sensitization, training and all, where has it led us so far? Who has given a thought to about the selection? You're selecting people who are not really suited to the ethos that they need to follow. Once they come into a controlled situation where they've got to deliver as a matter of service, not as a matter of authority. So do you select these people? You don't. Not in the IPS, not in the lower cadre, not in the middle cadre. So how much can you improve them? So they are influenced by the influences which are running at that time. And right now, there is a divisive influence which is running, and that has set the mindset. One. Number two, the working conditions of the police have hardly improved. We have states providing them with exotic cars and all. But what about the other things? The working hours, you know? And I did a survey as DG, and I found that majority of the policemen were suffering from diabetes. Has anyone looked at that? Do they have a strong health support system for all these constables? They don't. The poor fellow, after his duty, has to run to a hospital where he'll hardly get any kind of special treatment. He's pressed for time. Next time, he's back on duty. I tell you, this police is the greatest exploited department of the police, of the government, and for a very long time.
Yes.
Unless the government realizes this, this poor fellow, come what may, has to be on duty for 16 hours. Whereas the Babu comes there, 10 to 5 goes off.
Yes.
No responsibility. So these are things, you know, which are really hurtful. And unless these are addressed, you cannot improve the police in this country.
Well, I have completely agree with you.
You will never be able to improve unless these are some of the points.
Yes, absolutely, Mr. Sen. In fact, what you've just described, here are the statistics that even back that, based on this very survey that we're discussing tonight. Police personnel work 14 hours a day on an average. One in two personnel are working overtime regularly. That 8 out of 10 do not get paid for overtime work. One out of two personnel, one out of two, that's 50%, do not get their weekly off days. Obviously, they don't get off days on special occasions, on festivals. That's when the police bandobas is at max. Three out of the four cops said that 75% that workload is affecting their health. Pretty much what Mr. Sen was saying. We also need to look at this side. What is the environment we are creating for these policemen? What is the training we're giving them? How are we sensitizing them? How much of work are they being made to do? Are they giving, getting the respect that they should? Are they being given the freedom that they need to investigate a case fairly? And if we don't fix this problem, then night after night, unfortunately, we will be sitting here discussing botched up investigations, false cases, corrupt policemen. The only way we can improve the law and order in our country is to start by working on getting police reforms in this country. Will our government do that? It's the big question. Thank you so much for joining us on this debate.